I'm really thankful to the organizers for giving this honor to chair this also important session on endocrinology of love. Love, this four-letter word is possibly basis of all the humanity, all the life for that reason in this universe. Life without love is simply unimaginable, just unimaginable on this planet. So without wasting much of time, because this is such a topic one can talk on and on, as tons of literature has been written in almost all the cultures, all the societies, in all the ages on this topic of love. I must say that it's my proud privilege to introduce to this august gathering Professor Dr. Deepak Jumani from Mumbai. He is consultant sexual health physician, counselor, and AASECT certified sex therapist. He is ACS USA, FIAMS, MBBS from Bombay, PhD from USA, assistant professor, Department of Medicine, Sir JJ Government Hospital and Grant Medical College, Mumbai, diplomat, American Board of Clinical Sexology. His fellow Council of Sex Education and Parenthood International. His fellow of Indian Academy of Medical Specialties. His president, Indian Association of Sexology, Mumbai chapter. His editor, International Journal of Psychology. His president, Society for Preservation of Medical Ethics. Now I'll request this highly decorated general of our medical fraternity's academic force to please give us his talk.
Thank you, sir.
Dr. Jumani, please.
Thank you, sir, for that very loving introduction. At the outset, I thank Vitul, Dr. Noiria, Dr. Rajinder, and his whole team for inviting me here and giving me an opportunity to share my thoughts, views, concepts, and passion. And I really enjoyed making this talk, because love is such a thing which cannot be defined in just one sentence, or there's no meaning behind it. It's the whole thing in life. We all are, in fact, victims of love, whether we love to love our children, whether we love our profession, whether we love to listen to somebody, whether we love music. So we are all victims of love. And today, the advances in neurobiology, neurosciences, and neuroimaging has advanced so much that today we can identify certain areas in the brain which can tell us that this person is definitely in love. And we also can find out whether a person is monogamous, in which certain areas get really activated, and if he's polygamous, certain areas don't get deactivated. So let's understand what actually it is. Audio, please. I thank my teachers, Professor Joshi, Dr. O.P. Kapoor, and Dr. Prakash Kothari, and I beseech them to bless me always.
When all the good speakers start with a band like this.
I'm going to disclose what I'm going to offer. It's unlike Modi's GST, it's great sex therapy. I'll give you a little new perspective of what love is today. Unless we love and are loved, each one of us is alone, each one of us is deeply lonely. Dr. Harry Harlow in 1958, who's addressing while inaugurating the annual conference of American Psychological Association, said, "Love is a wondrous state, deep, tender, and rewarding. Because of its intimate and personal nature, it is regarded by some as an improper topic for experimental research." Way back in 1958, he thought there was no point in doing any research, and it was not possible. But today, we can really identify so many areas in the brain which get activated. We can understand the whole psychology, whole mechanisms, whole chemistry of love. Where is love situated? Is it in the brain or is it in the heart? An international study co-authored by Concordia basic scientists and psychology professor Jim Floss found that love and desire activate specific but related areas in the brain. When we think of heart, it's a place where we have feelings, emotions, beliefs and values. And when we think of brain, it's a place of logic, understanding, and it's a domain of cognition. It requires evidence, it requires science. And when we are in love, both conflict with each other. Brain tries to analyze, judge, whereas heart just flows with the thought. But heart today also has been identified as a little brain because there are 40,000 sensory neurons relaying to the brain from the heart. There are hormones produced in the heart itself. Neurons within the heart are able to learn, remember, and make decisions independent of brain. There are electromagnetic fields of the heart which are incredibly strong, and it can also excite a synchronous rhythm. And that which divides between the heart and brain is our mind itself. In humans, we call love as an attachment system. There are three types of love which exist in humans. One is the maternal love, romantic love, and filial love, which amongst the friends. And these all have evolutionary purposes, either to bond mutually with nice things, perpetuation of species, and care of offsprings. Love in humans, I will be talking only about romantic love. I won't be talking about maternal love and the other loves. It could be maternal. The different stages of love are, the love, lust is the first stage of love and is driven by the hormones, testosterone and estrogen, both in women. A male's physical features indicate higher androgen levels. A female's estrogens indicate higher estrogen levels. So the first stage is driven by testosterone and estrogen in both men and women. Stage two is the stage of attraction. This is amazing time when you are truly love struck and can think of nothing else. Scientists think the three main neurotransmitters which are involved in this stage are adrenaline, dopamine, and serotonin. And once you are more involved in attraction or touching each other, leads to attachment, which leads to bond between the couples. And scientists think that there might be two major hormones involved in this feeling of attachment. And these are oxytocin and vasopressin. So whole chemistry of love depends upon drive, attraction, and attachment. Romantic love has its own components. We mammals, when we mate, there is sex drive, which is motivates individuals to seek a range of mating partners. Attraction motivates individuals to prefer and pursue specific partners. An attachment motivates individuals to remain together long enough to complete species-specific parenting duties. When you are in love, especially romantic love, certain things which have been observed in men are they have increased energies. They focus attention only on their beloved. They follow obsessively. They have affiliated gestures toward them. they become possessive about it, and the motivation to win a preferred mating partner. And all these today have been studied to have neuroendocrine roots, smell and sight. In humans, the major odor producing organ, the skin, the apocrine sebaceous glands, which develop during puberty. And these are located everywhere on the body, but concentrated at six places: the axilla, the nipples, the pubic, genital, circumanal, circumoral, lips, eyelids, and the outer ear. 1 gram of axillary hair will produce certain hormones, whereas DHEAs and endosterone sulfate and 5-desings are present 1,000 times in these amounts in these places. Pheromones, steroids, androstenedione in women exerts a positive effect of her mood, cognition, and heightens the sympathetic nervous system. The free steroid present in the hair surface do not begin until you are at puberty and above. So Baer et al. Suggested there is a possible link between steroid hormone action and the induction of the production by investigating localization of androgen receptors, estrogen receptors in male and females. And how did we get to know about all these things? How did humans understand that there are certain areas in the brains which get activated? Helen Fisher and Lang and Young studied beautifully modest rats known as voles, prairie voles. The peculiarity of these prairie voles are that they are monogamous. These are the prairie voles. And we also have mountain and meadow voles. These are almost similar, but these are polygamous voles. Pair bonding and partner preferences was learned from these voles itself. Prairie voles, Microtus orchestrator, they are monogamous, biparental, where the other two voles are non-monogamous and uniparental. Prairie voles are so committed to their partners that they never take any other partner after losing their own mate. So, important thing to understand here is that we understood about monogamous changes in the brain with the help of prairie voles. There are other neuroendocrine factors which are involved in the love are neurotransmitters like oxytocin, vasopressin, dopamine, serotonin, cortisol, nerve growth factor and testosterone. Lot of brain regions which involve and reveal all these things in various areas are also identified. Now oxytocin and vasopressin have been found on chromosome 20. Both are nanopeptides, but they have two amino acids different. Though they are structurally same, but slight difference in their actions. Conventionally, they all have endocrine actions, supraoptic and paraventricular nuclei. And mainly oxytocin, we know, has been used or has been found in excess when during labor contractions, or they contract the myoepithelial cell of the breast and they help in milk letdown. And vasopressin, we knew, had water balance and blood pressure regulations. But now we have understood that there are certain neurotransmitter actions for these two. And these are due to the receptors which have been located, oxytocin receptor and vasopressin receptors. How do we understand in prairie voles what happens when they mate? When they mate, there are nuclei present in the brain which exert certain effects on the ventral pallidum, motor cortex, and the ventral tegmental area gets activated. It produces dopamine and releases it to nuclear ambience, prefrontal cortex. And the olfactory bulb, which gets activated due to the pheromones, supplies signals to the amygdala, from where there are projections of the ventral pallidum, lateral septum. And the preoptic area of the hypothalamus also sends signals, oxytocinergic signals, to amygdala, nuclear ambience, and prefrontal cortex. A functional MRI which was done in these voles, they found that there were, in prairie voles, oxytocin receptors present in nuclear ambience, acumens, CP and the prefrontal cortex, and there were vasopressin receptors in the lateral septum and the ventral pallidum. These were in the prairie wolves, which were monogamous. But in mountain wolves, there were hardly any oxytocin receptors, little vasopressin receptors which were seen in the lateral septum and the ventral. So there were definitely certain areas which had excess of oxytocin receptors and vasopressin receptors in prairie wolves, which were monogamous. Now what scientists did, they blocked oxytocin in prairie wolves, okay, by injecting antioxytocin or oxytocin antagonist. And they found these prairie wolves who were monogamous became polygamous. And they also blocked the vasopressin receptors in the prairie wolves by giving them vasopressin antagonist, and they also became polygamous. So it was possible for us to understand what is responsible for a person to become monogamous. So oxytocin is responsible for a human to be monogamous. So that's why it's called cuddle hormone, trust hormone, love hormone. In transgenic meadow wolves, whereas in prairie wolves who were monogamous, they blocked the oxytocin receptors and the vasopressin receptors, they became monogamous. Whereas when in the other wolves who were monogamous, when they blocked, they became monogamous. They blocked their receptors, they became monogamous. So we can now identify the states of humans when they are polygamous, which areas of the brain have been activated. And they also have also understood that the time required for a male to identify the male-female partner was much earlier, and when the oxytocin was blocked in these patients, the time required was almost similar. They recognized them as a stranger. So oxytocin plays a greater role in humans to be monogamous and be in love for a longer time. Differential expression of oxytocin and vasopressin in monogamous was studied. There was strong association with dopamine reward system, responsible for partner preference and bonding after mating. Blocking of oxytocin and vasopressin in prairie wolves made them promiscuous. Expressing prairie wolf receptors in mountain wolves makes them monogamous. So dopamine is another neurotransmitter which is responsible for pair bonding. And when they mate with the monogamous partners, the D2 and D1 receptors activate in the certain areas of the brain, like nucleus ambiens and CP and other places. And when anti-dopaminergics were given to them, these receptors disappeared and they found a very long time to get activated. So love is nothing but an orchestra of endocrine soup between oxytocin, vasopressin and dopamine. The neurobiologic pair bonding model which is understood is because of oxytocin and vasopressin, which gives social clues which are required for individual recognition. Mesolimbic dopamine involved in reinforcing and reward of learning, and concurrent activation of the neuropeptide and dopamine receptors in the reward systems mating leads to a conditioned partner preference observed as a pair bond. So initially we have a sex drive which is because of testosterone and estrogen, then oxytocin and vasopressin, and dopamine continues the reward system. And this is all in the wolves. How do we imply this in we humans? These are the love areas of the brain in the wolves, and we also have a similar pattern seen in our brains. We also have nuclear acumens, hypothalamus, amygdala, etc. And there are certain areas of the brain which get activated when we are in love, and certain areas which get deactivated. And these areas which are activated are medial insula, anterior cingulate cortex, hippocampus, nucleus accumbens, and these are important components of the brain reward system.
whereas the areas which get deactivated are amygdala, frontal cortex, prefrontal cortex, temporal lobe, parietotemporal junction. And this is responsible for a person who does not fear in love. There is amelioration of fear. People who are in love, they don't bother about anything. There is a decrease in negative emotions and judgments. The mentalizing, evaluating and other intentions are impaired. This is a very good diagram where it shows maternal and romantic love areas in the brain get deactivated. In the maternal love, hypothalamus doesn't get activated because that's responsible for testosterone and sex hormones. Whereas in romantic love, you will find all the areas including the hypothalamus getting activated. So you will see network involved in negative emotions, regions involved in critical assessment, brain areas, certain areas getting inactivated when seeing the pictures of the loved ones, certain areas getting deactivated. So oxytocin enhances the brain reward system responses in men viewing the face of their female partner. A beautiful study was done and they found that when they saw their partners even after a long time, those oxytocin receptors got activated. Another thing is serotonin, which is inversely related to cortisol. Depletion is seen in early stages of romantic love. And love shares many symptoms like obsessive compulsive disorder, anxiety, stress. And normalization of these levels occur after 1 or 2 years. And cortisol is increased HPA's hypothalamus pituitary activity in the early stages of love for 6 months. It is related to stress, insecurity. It does promote pair bonding, overcomes neophobia. Neophobia is nothing but when you meet some new person, you have a fear. So it overcomes that. It normalizes the axis once you are in a long-term relations, and it opposes actions of oxytocin and vasopressin. Nerve growth factor is also involved in love. Testosterone also gets decreased in the initial stages. There are gender differences of romantic love and maternal love is different. And what stimulates a person to produce oxytocin in mother's antepartum thoughts about unborn child? Visual clues like child's face which she imagines, breastfeeding, touch, hug of a child. And what stimulates oxytocin in romantic love are olfactory, sense, auditory, when they hear somebody saying I love you. Visual cues, hugs, massage, breast and nipple stimulation and orgasms. Oxytocin during initial stages of romantic attachment has interactive reciprocity. They sent 43 couples under MRI scans and they found that these singles had very less oxytocin. When they met for the first time, the levels increased, and again after 6 months they met, they assessed, they found the levels were increased. So oxytocin levels determine the prognosis, because once these couples who were living together were separated and they found their oxytocin levels decreased. And they also have a linear reciprocity. So new lovers had substantially high plasma levels of oxytocin as compared to non-attached singles. There was a cross-generation. So it's how do we develop oxytocin receptor? It's since birth, when mother breastfeeds us, when she cuddles us. And this is from the mother and from the childhood we learn to love. So today, friends, oxytocin has a versatile role right from birth to adulthood. At birth, it helps in parturition, uterine contractions. It helps in lactations. In maternal, it provides proper parenting, social interactions, social recognitions. In adulthood, it bounds and you get the feeling of trust. It also improves penile erection and female receptivity. It also does not allow others to come in your life, so it allows you to be monogamous. So that's why oxytocin is also called a love potion, trust hormone, cuddle hormone, fidelity hormone, healing hormone, feel good hormone. Positive, we have intranasal oxytocin available. It is anxiolytic. It increases partner attractiveness, improves fidelity by making men keep a greater distance from other women. It provides empathy, improves trust, improves social attention, recognition, and appraisals. Intranasal oxytocin have been used in conflict resolution as an adjunct to marital counseling, because it increases cooperativeness, it increases the understanding and perspective taking, it produces positive reflection. It is proven beyond doubt to be used in autism, depression, anxiety and schizophrenia. It also has pleiotropic effects, it's called healing. It down-regulates the HPA axis, ameliorating chronic stress. Oxytocin receptors in the heart are precursors, they improve heart development. Differentiation of stem cells to cardiomyocytes have been seen. It facilitates neurogenesis and repair. It is also anti-inflammatory and has an antioxidant properties. So all these explain the adverse impact of social isolation and morbidity. So in case if a patient comes to us, a couple, and the wife complains of infidelity with him, we can try counseling as well as giving intranasal oxytocin to them. Friends, a life without love is not a life fully lived. Although research into mechanisms through which love protects us against stress and disease in its infancy, the knowledge will ultimately increase our understanding. But what we have to understand, we have much to learn even today about love and much to learn from love. This is my study for last several years. Love is nothing but 9 nouns of love. It is 9 ideas. I call it 9 loves of love. Number 1, it's an idealized ambition. It's a deal which people make consciously or unconsciously. It's a bond that gets created once you are in love. And then it's a moral commitment. It's a great intrapsychic day-to-day management work to maintain that commitment which you already have. It's a force in nature. It's a transient emotion. It's an illusion and also a stop sign. Once you are in love, you don't want anything else. It's a label we give to a range of transient emotional experiences which we do when we are in love. So these are the 9 nines of nouns of love. But the most illuminating thing in love is the verbs of love. What are these? Falling in love is very easy. Staying in love is also easy. Being in love is also easy. But what is more exhilarating and more challenging is to stay in love throughout. Plato beautifully said, the irrational desire that leads us towards the enjoyment of beauty and overpowers the judgment that directs us towards what is right is called love. Nish also said, there is always some madness in love, but there is always some reason in madness. My take-home message is a very simple thing.
Do I what?
Do you love me?
Do I love you?
Well,
with our daughters getting married and this trouble in the town, you're upset, you're worn out. Go inside, go lie down. Maybe it's indigestion.
No, Golda. I'm asking you a question. Do you love me?
You're a fool.
I know. But do you love me?
Do I love you?
Well,
for 25 years I've washed your clothes, cooked your meals, cleaned your house, given you children, milked your cow. After 25 years, why talk about love right now?
Love. Golden. Do you love me?
Do I what?
Do you love me?
Do I love you?
Well,
with our daughters getting married and this trouble in the town, you're upset, you're worn out. Go inside, go lie down. Maybe it's indigestion.
No, Golda, I'm asking you a question. Do you love me?
You're a fool.
I know. But do you love me?
Do I love you?
Well,
for 25 years I've washed your clothes, cooked your meals, cleaned your house, given you children, milked your cow. After 25 years, why talk about love right now?
Golden, the first time I met you was on our wedding day. I was scared.
I was shy.
I was nervous.
So was I.
But my father and my mother said we'd learn to love each other. And now I'm asking, Golden, do you love me?
I'm your wife.
I know. But do you love me?
Do I love him?
Well?
For 25 years I've lived with him, fought with him, starved with him. 25 years my bed is his. If that's not love, what is?
And you love me.
I suppose I do.
Then I suppose I love you too. It doesn't change a thing. But even so, after 25 years, it's nice to
friends, love is a noun and a verb, both. It's all about connection, disconnection, reconnection, disconnection, reconnection, etc., etc., etc. So my last slide is, oxytocin, which was once considered as a labor hormone responsible for uterine contraction and milk ejection, is today a love hormone. And we have intranasal oxytocin sprays available. Oxytocin and vasopressin mediate love via dopaminergic reward systems in the brain, which have now been studied with functional MRI and PET scans. Beautifully studied, identified, serum oxytocin levels have been studied. And we know this man has high oxytocin receptors, high oxytocin levels. He is monogamous, he is polygamous if he has less. And this has been understood by amazing neuroimaging mechanisms today, available today. Friends, believe me, like sex, love really has no expiry date. Thank you all for your love.
I would like to request the chairpersons to kindly honor Dr. Jumani.